O God, come to my assistance.
Lord, make haste to help me.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
trusted in the Lord, let him save him. Let him release him if this is his friend.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and feet and lay me in the dust of death.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
I can count every one of my bones. These people stare at me and gloat. They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots for my robe.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
I will tell your name to the faithful and praise you where they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. All descendants of Jacob, give him glory.
Please stand.
Let us pray.
Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that though in our weakness we fail, we may be revived through the passion of your only begotten Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Against only you have I sinned.
us back the joy of our salvation, and renew in us a willing spirit. O Lord, open my lips, Lord, open my lips,
and we will sing your praise. Create in me a clean heart, O God, a clean heart, O God, create in me.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, grant us so to celebrate the mysteries of the Lord's Passion, that we may merit to receive your pardon. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, set me free. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God. Because of all my foes, I have become a reproach, an object of scorn to my neighbors and of fear to my friends. Those who see me in the street flee from me. I am forgotten like someone dead and have become like a broken vessel.
Father,
But as for me, I trust in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. My lot is in your hands. Deliver me from the hands of my enemies and those who pursue. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your merciful love. Be strong, let your heart take courage, all who hope in the
Let us pray. O God, who willed your Son to submit for our sake to the yoke of the cross, so that you might drive from us the power of the enemy, grant us, your servants, to attain the grace of the resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Quick transit is where we are, mobile. gladsomeness.
Secure.
tutors come upon her where she is narrowly confined. Dalet. The roads to Zion mourn for lack of pilgrims going to her feasts. All her gateways are deserted, her priests can only groan. Her virgins sigh, she is in bitter grief. Her foes are uppermost, her enemies are at ease. The Lord has punished her for her many sins. Her little ones have been led away, captive before the foe.
Jerusalem, Jerusalem, return to the Lord your God.
Gone from daughter Zion is all her glory. Her princes are like rams that find no pasture. They have gone off without strength before their captors. Zion. Jerusalem is mindful of the days of her wretched homelessness, when her people fell into enemy hands and she had no one to help her. When her foes gloated over her and laughed at her ruin. Because of the sin of which she is guilty, Jerusalem is defiled. All who once esteemed her think her vile now that they see her nakedness. She herself groans and turns away. Her filth is on her skirt. She gave no thought how she would end. Astounding is her downfall with no one to console her. Look, O Lord, upon her misery. For the enemy has triumphed. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, return to the Lord your God.
The foe stretched out his hand to all her treasures. She has seen those nations enter her sanctuary, whom you forbade to come into your assembly. Come. All her people groan, searching for bread. They give their treasures for food to retain the breath of life. Look, O Lord, and see how worthless I have become. Lament. Come, all you who pass by the way, look and see whether there be any suffering like my suffering, which has been dealt me when the Lord afflicted me on the day of his blazing wrath. From on high he sent fire down into my very frame. He spread a net for my feet and overthrew. He left me desolate in pain all the day. No. He has kept watch over my sins. By his hand they have been braided together. They have settled like a yoke about my neck. He has brought my strength to its knees. The Lord has delivered me into their grip. I am unable to rise.
Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, and that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus did not cling to his equality with God. We sit here tonight immersed in beauty, the simplicity of the diminishing candlelight invites us to introspection in this most holy week. The richness of voices and music, even with haunting melodies, touch our hearts as well as our minds and invite us to deep reflection on the one who did not regard his equality with God as something to be grasped, but rather emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. Since Sunday, we have heard the suffering servant songs from the prophet Isaiah. As we hear the passion narrative bring those ancient prophecies to life, we hear that God's servant learns from what he suffers, and suffers he does, not turning his back on God, but rather allowing God to train his tongue and open his ear to be able to speak a rousing word to the weary. We know how rare true listening is, how hard it is to stay still and stay quiet, something our parents tried to instill in us in church long time ago, and yet it never comes easily. In our noisy world, we can hardly keep up with the bombardment of words coming at us from all sides. The noisier the band, the more obnoxious the celebrity, the more outrageous the lies of the politician, the more they win the coveted prize of attention. Yet Isaiah tells us that God is more attentive to the bruised reed and the smoldering wick, the wounded sheep and the bitter cries of Ramah. The media hears the noise of bomb attacks. God hears the weeping of mothers, children, fathers, and spouses whose loved ones become more fodder for the machines of war. The word that will rouse is indeed the word made flesh, who is far less interested in wowing us with signs and wonders than encountering us in silence and opening us to an encounter with his Father.
A life-giving encounter that requires us to see, to hear, and to feel differently. For 2 years, our Universal Church has been immersed in a process of listening deeply, of having conversations in the Spirit, of resisting the temptation of overreaction and jumping to conclusions or condemnations. That is the process of synodality, of walking together. But to really encounter each other, to really hear each other, to really discover our common humanity with each other and through each other in the next pew, across the literal or metaphorical aisle, or around the globe, it's just not that easy. Jesus did not cling to his equality with God. What does this Holy Week invite us to let go of? What are we clinging to so tightly that we can't loosen the grip? Rather, he emptied himself. It's being so full that blocks our ability to hear the other and to feel what the other feels. It's our fullness with stuff, or with ourselves, or with status, or with privilege, or with being right or being righteous, that doesn't allow us to hear, much less to suffer with, or even to be obedient. Found in human appearance, St. Paul says, Jesus humbled himself, becoming obedient even to the point of death. Our Messiah isn't acting. That would literally be hypocrisy. Our Messiah is not going through the motions, a God without feelings, appearing to suffer like his people. God is not going through any motions when he takes on the form of a slave. He takes on that form for real and for eternity. And he does it in solidarity with the innocent who suffer, and even with the guilty who don't know the harm they cause, even the harm they cause to themselves. Cheeks whose beard have been plucked, a face not shielded from buffets and spitting, a back that knows beatings. They're all hard lessons, Isaiah tells us. Lessons that so many of us think our privilege excuses us from having to learn. In the wondrous beauty which surrounds us tonight, we hear Jeremiah's laments over the once crowded, gorgeous city teeming with pilgrims, a city that's not all that far from Gaza, which knows the kind of destruction Jeremiah mourns. The city, too, is emptied out. What do we lament? What should we lament? Empty houses of worship, empty plans, empty words, empty aspirations, the loss of our once brilliant optimism. Because of this, God greatly exalted him. What a way to earn glory. But it's the only way to be glorified. Let's not cling, but let's empty ourselves of all that is not godlike, in remembrance of him who did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself.
In this time of the Lord's Passion, when Christ offered prayers and supplications to his Father with loud cries and tears, let us humbly beseech God that in answer to his Son's reverent submission, he may in mercy hear our prayers also.
That the Church, the Bride of Christ, may be more fully cleansed by his blood in this time of his Passion, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That through the blood of Christ's cross, all things in the world may be brought to peace for the sake of salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may grant fortitude and patience to all who through sickness or hardship have a share in Christ's Passion, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may be all be led through the Lord's Passion and Cross to the glory of his Resurrection, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. O God, who in this season give your Church the grace to imitate devoutly the Blessed Virgin Mary in contemplating the Passion of Christ, grant, we pray, through her intercession, that we may cling more firmly each day to your only begotten Son, and come at last to the fullness of his grace, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Let us kneel. Please stand.
Let us pray. O God, who by the passion of Christ, your Son, our Lord, abolish the death inherited from ancient sin by every succeeding generation, grant that just as being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man of earth, so by the sanctification of grace, we may bear the image of the man of heaven, through Christ our Lord.